All right, guys, we are back once again on another interview. This time we've got the great Niels.
Hi.
It's good to have you on.
Thank you.
This is such a long time coming. I know you and I have been kind of exposed to each other on the Twitter circles for years now. And I've always really appreciated your material, especially because, I mean, we see eye to eye on the dynamics between men and women. And a lot of times you just see a lot of the manosphere, you know, I'm just call it bluntly retardation. And, you know, but one of the things that there's a lot of people who are kind of in alignment, but if we're just being honest here, doesn't mean that they're bad with women, so to speak. But, you know, maybe they're from much more of a traditional background. And it's very much about, you know, obviously masculinity, and we care about masculinity too. But you have a really, really deep experience, so to speak, with women from even the seducer standpoint. And I think it's a really, really interesting voice. And so I'm really curious about your journey. I know you do erotic hypnosis, and we're going to get into that, but just tell me a bit about, you know, how you stumbled into this corner of the internet and your sort of journey with women.
Well, it's not a very exciting background story, but it's, goes back all the way to when I was 17. So what happened was I got ill, and it forced me to stay home for quite a bit. So I guess I was pretty much isolated, and for like 3 or 4 months. And then when I got back to school, I mean, you have to imagine, right? Like, if you're at home for 4 months, barely talking to them, because this was, well, we had MSN Messenger. That was what we had. So, you know, like, you type like 1 or 2 hours a day with some friends, but you didn't have cell phones or anything. So I didn't really have contact with anyone. And when I got back, I got this crush on the girl. It didn't make any sense because, you know, but it's like, if you're isolated for 4 months, then it just takes like this and you fall in love, right?
Yeah.
So I got a crush on the girl, got rejected. And then I just went online, like, hey, how to get girls. And I stumbled across the Book of Puk, which to this day is pretty much the best thing I've ever read on game. So I was very fortunate to, you know, like, immediately find like one of the best things ever. And it kind of just started from there. Not saying that I immediately turned into this sort of Don Juan or whatever, but, you know, that's where the journey started.
Book of Puk, for guys who aren't familiar with it, is this kind of mysterious classic from this anonymous guy. I guess it was in the early 2010s, like 2010, 2011, 2000.
No, before. The original material was written around 2000 to 2003. And then someone put it, also not Puk himself, but someone else felt like it was so good that he or she put it all together in a book, because it was never meant to be a book. It's just a bunch of blog posts, like forum posts.
Yeah, yeah.
From the I think the forum still exists. It's called the So Suave.
Oh, forum. Yeah, So Suave, yeah.
So it's quite funny when you go back there, because you see some of the people that are still around. You see him back then as well.
The aughts were such an incredible year for that information. I mean, it was the Wild West, and, you know, I know there's some really serious OGs who were in, you know, the attraction pickup circles even prior. But once the game came out, and I mean, that's when it started to hit the mainstream, and that sort of those 5 years bookending the release of that book on both directions was such like a, you just kind of had to be there. You know what I mean? It was really an interesting time. But yeah, the Book of Puk is it's a PDF. It's free for people to get. I think that one of the things that's very interesting about it is just, it's all very practical stuff, but it has a very energetic feel to it. Like it, it,
yeah.
I think it approaches from a positive perspective with women.
I felt like it's one big mental model, but somehow it's packaged very practically. But it's very much about the way of thinking about dating, and instead of, you know, it's not just about do X, Y, and then Z happens. It's about, you know, you need to look at life in this way. You need to look at women this way. You need to look at yourself this way. And it has this very positive vibe. Like, you never really catch any like misogyny or whatever. I think in book, it's just
good vibes, good information, good vibes. So you start with the Book of Pook and kind of take me from there.
Well, I grew up in a small town, and it took me another 2 years or so before I went to college. So nothing much happened then. Also because it took me quite a while to recover from being sick. So I guess dating really started for me in 2009. I went to college. I actually had a girlfriend for most of college. At least for my bachelor's, and then afterwards I went to the UK for 2 years to study there. And had a pretty, well, I guess nasty breakup. And I had like a hardcore red pill phase for a bit, I'd say like between 2013, 2014. Mm-hmm. And then I realized like, oh, this is so toxic, like wasn't helping my dating whatsoever. And I just, you know, like one day you wake up, you look in the mirror, like I'm becoming a nasty person. Like, this is not who I want to be. And I never really downright went into the path of hating women or something, but just, you know, you get this very utilitarian way of looking at dating. Like, I give you so much attention, you need to give me so much sex, or you need to give me this or that. And so then one day I was like, you know, like, so I finished college. And I was like, yeah, no, I shouldn't do this. This is just, it's not going to bring me anywhere. It's not making me happy. And, you know, like, the quality of women I was dating was actually just going down, because, you know, the more utilitarian, nihilistic you become, that's also what you attract, right?
So
then after college, so this was 2014, and so back then the job market was horrible, and it took me about 7 months to get my first proper job. So like, I was stuck with my parents in the small town again. Mm-hmm. And then soon after my first job, I got an offer to start work for the city of Amsterdam. And then I moved there. And that's I guess, in 2015, that's when like really started, because then I didn't have that toxic mindset anymore, or at least not as much. So I was like on the right path. And then Amsterdam is a great city for dating, at least in my opinion. So that's when it started. And yeah.
So this, one of the things that I'm really interested about with your perspective on dating, and give that, you know, just real quick, if you can sum it up, your orientation, but the difference between short term and long term, like, so after that initial relationship and that, you know, that bad breakup, have you been mostly in short term relationships or longer term ones? What is sort of the range with that?
I've done both. So I have like one, I mean, I'm going to keep it a little bit vague, because I had like one rule when I started my Twitter account, was like, I'll never really talk about my current dating situation, because it's just, multiple reasons.
Yeah.
But one of them is, I don't want to be the dating guru who then, you know, it's like, oh, look at my perfect relationship, look at my perfect marriage of 4 kids. And then, you know, things aren't going that well in your relationship, but you have to keep on the facade. And then, like, you know, like, because then your private life becomes your business as well. Mm-hmm. And then let's say like things go wrong and you go into a divorce or whatever, you know, then the entire business also explodes, because you're supposed to be the happy family. And then suddenly, so I'm going to keep it a little bit vague. So one of the reasons, so basically I've had 2 long-term relationships in my life, which were both past the 3-year mark. And in between shorter relationships, and the shorter ones usually somewhere between 3 to 6 months, because I do believe that long-term dating should be a serious thing where, well, maybe not marriage per se, but you do aim for a long-term commitment with children. So if after, like, you know, like the shorter ones, it's more about the excitement, the fun. And then after 3 or 6 months, kind of, I think from both ends, the excitement wears off a little bit, right? Because you get more into the routines and it's becomes way more effort to keep things exciting without making them serious, I guess. So usually, yeah, so either it's always been 3 to 6 months maximum or like 3+ years.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've always found that like the sort of 3 to 6 month relationships, I've called them tier two. And one of the things I noticed that happens is that, and it really starts to hit around the 3 month mark. Sometimes with some girls it's a little earlier, but it's usually 3 months with maybe in like an extension of 3 months. But you kind of hit an intimacy block. So you realize that in order to continue things going forward, you have to get closer in a way that's incongruent to the dynamic.
Yeah, because it's an emotional investment. Like you can't hang around someone for 2 years and not be emotionally invested.
Yeah.
So, I mean, not to sound too wooey, but it costs you a piece of your soul if you stick around too long with someone that you don't connect with well enough. And every relationship, you take something from it, but you also lose something in your relationship. So you can't keep doing that. Like sometimes you see people who do it, you know, like they go from one relationship to the other, to the next, to the next, to the next. And then after like 10 to 15 relationships, it just, I don't know, it just wears you down. You know, like something breaks in you. But the first 3 months is just about exploring. So then it's all fun and games. And I do enter every relationship with the mindset of I'm going to see if this is something serious or not. So I'm never, because, you know, that's like, between 2013, 2014, I would be like, oh yeah, like how long can I string her along, you know, get what I want. And then I realized that this is very, I just did that for like 1.5 years, but then I felt like this is so toxic. You know, like if I keep doing this, I'm going to be a very bitter, sour man, and I'm never going to be in a happy relationship. Mm-hmm. So ever since then, I'm like, okay, if I start dating someone, it's always with the intent to see if it can progress to something serious. And then often after 3 months, you know, and sometimes, you know, like, okay, it's not going to be something, but we're still having fun, so we can keep pushing this for another 3 months. But then, you know, eventually someone either falls in love or out of love, and then you just need to quit it.
It's really profound what you said there about how every relationship, you know, you gain something, but you lose something. And you know, I think people get really focused on what you learn. I mean, I can speak true, like, for myself here. I often talk about, oh, what you learn when you date someone. But you're totally right. There is an extraction that also occurs, a burnout that occurs. And if you just keep doing it, then it does start to sap away something from your soul. And you can see, I've seen guys even who are really, you know, they're good people, they're warm individuals, but with the serial dating, there's a level of like cynicism that starts to come into play even when they're successful. And it really does make it harder and harder for them to attract and the kind of girls that they would, you know, theoretically want to have. And what's interesting is that until they hit a breaking point, it's usually that, like, even the quality of the girls kind of goes down. Like, I know one guy who just absolutely incredible with women, and he was very much like this. And I looked up to him a lot. I learned a lot from him. But I started to see this play out, and eventually he ended up getting with, like, you know, a really messed up girl, got her pregnant, and that was a whole disaster. But in the end, it was good for him because that is what actually reset him. And now he's with like an awesome girl and they're, you know, they're getting married and everything. But it's like he kept kind of going down that path.
Yeah, like it's nothing in this world, this is a Dutch saying, like nothing in this world is free except for the sun. Like everything yeah. else always comes with a price, which isn't a bad thing necessarily, but like I like to give the example of, look at, you know, if you look at teens, right? Like you look at 2 16-year-olds and they have their first relationship. And you see them sit on the park bench together. It's a very naive, innocent kind of love. Mm-hmm. And you will never get that back because, you know, like 16-year-olds, 6 months later, they break up and they hate each other. You know, like they crush, the entire world collapses, everything, drama, drama. And of course, you know, like after a while, you recover from it. But you never, ever have that raw abandonment, naive puppy love.
Yeah.
You just don't get it twice, because the second time you always have in the back of your head that memory of the breakup, you know, things can go wrong, or, you know, like, oh, she kissed another guy, so maybe this girl, my ex kissed another guy, so this girl might also cheat on me. You know, you always get the, so as you progress, you get these experiences, and many of them are great, and some of them just are not so great. And those negative experiences do stick with you. And many of them are good because you learn from them. You know, like you learn to read the signals, you know, like the warning signs. Like because your first girlfriend when you're 16, she might be crazy as hell, you don't know. But, you know, the consequences aren't that bad. Because, I mean, what's going to happen? She's 16, you're 16, you're going to break up, and you're going to cry a little bit over it, that's it. When you're 28 or 30, 32, you can't make the same mistakes. You can't. So, but the early relationships did help you get smarter in that way. But like you said, they do make you more cynical, which of course you need a little bit of cynicism in love, as sad as that sounds. But you just can't have too much of it, because eventually, let's say if you date 100 women seriously, I mean, I don't know how you're going to find the time, but let's say you do it, like 100 women, and you date each of them for a year, so like huge overlap, but still. Every relationship is going to give you something negative as well as positive. But eventually, if you get like 100 negatives and you stack them up, you become very cynical, because you've pretty much, by the time you've seriously dated 100 women, you've had every nasty thing that can happen to you in a relationship. You know, you've been cheated on, you know, bad behavior, betrayal, you know, you probably have one or two psychos in there. So you become very cynical. And that's something you have to be careful of.
Yeah, you know, you have to learn from these experiences. I mean, I think that there's this argument about whether or not, if you're in a relationship with someone, is that the way to learn about women, just going deep? Or is it going out and dating a bunch of women and seeing how they're really different, getting a wide sampling? And I think that there's value to both of them. They both offer different things. A guy who's only just dating one woman after another, there are things about women he's not going to understand that a guy who's been married to one woman, only been with one woman for 20 years, that guy is going to know things about women that other guy doesn't know, and obviously vice versa. So much of this stuff is about awareness, paying attention to your experiences, because I think a lot of people just go through this, you know, that's where you hit these stagnation moments where you're serial dating, but you're, you know, if you're doing the same thing over and over and over again, well, then you are actually avoiding growth.
And I think it's also, you know, both these things, it's not about just about what you learn about women, it's also what you learn about yourself. So if you've only ever been with one woman and you're with her for like 25 years, you learn certain things about yourself that you wouldn't learn if you date 25 women, but you only date them for a week, all of them. But also vice versa, because every woman has something that she can teach you. But also, you know, like it takes time to learn those things from her. Like, so if you date 20 women in 1 year, you're going to learn very different things than if you date one woman for an entire year.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And, you know, I think... the benefit of going deep is that when with dating, just more like surface dating, guys can get really good at developing the perfect dating persona. So it's kind of like you're seeing who you are, but maybe because of the way that you present yourself, you're only seeing yourself from your most, you know, favorable angle. And so you can almost like I've found that in seduction, there's an element of the seducer seducing himself with the image that he presents to the woman. And I know I can say one of the things for me was that when I got into a serious relationship again, after I had really developed that persona, like I was like in love with myself, you know, I had, and there was all sorts of stuff that then came up in a relationship that, you know, like, no, I don't like that angle. You know, I don't want to see that angle, you know, but I do think on the flip side, while in a relationship, a healthy relationship, you see yourself comprehensively. In an unhealthy relationship, the other person can only kind of show you your bad angles. Mm-hmm. And that can be really wrecking for people's self-esteem. So it's really about like, you want to get the full picture of who you are. And, you know, and the awareness is being able to say, okay, yeah, I've got enough from this experience. I can move on to the next one. And I think in a healthy relationship, there's actually always more levels that you can go through.
Yeah, and I think it's also in the beginning, you can sort of charm someone so they don't, so they're not very critical. So you start dating a new girl and, you know, you put on your charming self and, you know, you use game a little bit. You use it's 5:30 here. What I meant to say is, the beginning, you can sort of overwhelm her, right? So you, let's say you're very stubborn, but you get away with it because, you know, she's crazy about you. You're smooth about it. But after a while, you know, she isn't razzle dazzled anymore. You know, like she starts to see the real you. Mm-hmm. And she's not impressed anymore with your stubbornness, if it's, you know, causing her to stand on the side of the highway because you're refusing to like call for help. So you just like want to fix the engine yourself, and she's just standing there for 2 hours. And that's when the feedback starts rolling in. You know, like, so if that happens after like 2 weeks into dating, you can get away with it. You know, you can bluff your way out of it. If it happens 2 years into dating, then I mean, you're gonna get it thrown into your face. Like, you're going to have to see, she becomes that mirror that reflects your own limitations. You know, like, oh shit, like, yeah, I am very stubborn. Maybe I should do something about this. Like, you can't bullshit your way out of it anymore, because she catches up as well, right? Like, not to make it too technical, but like, everyone has techniques. And the first time you use a technique on someone, you get away with it. You know, like certain patterns or certain ways of wiggling out. You know, like some people, for instance, always deflect. So you say something about like, oh, Niels, you need to be more punctual. And I'll just give like a whataboutism or something. Oh, yeah, but you should be doing that. And the first time that might work. But the 10th time I tried to do that with you, you're like, oh, here it goes again. Like, I know how to catch this. And then you just lay it down. And I have nowhere to wiggle to, like, because you caught me out. And I think that's something that a long-term relationship does that casual dating just can't do.
Yeah.
And also, I think that's also why a lot of relationships die out at the 3 to 6 month mark, is because people are simply not willing to do that introspective work, at least not for that other person. So they might be willing to do it for the right person. Some people are just not willing to do it at all, and that's why they'll never get into a long-term healthy relationship. But it might also just be that you're not willing to do it for her. And then it's like, okay, it's better if we part our ways. Or maybe she's not willing to do it for you. That's also possible.
Yeah, and I also think in some of those short-term relationships, what you realize is that there actually is a compatibility issue. That it's not like she's just showing you something about yourself that, you know, you like, oh, wow, like, I need to change. This is a negative pattern. It's that you realize, in order for you guys to mesh, well, actually, you'd have to be somebody completely different.
Yeah. It's you can compare it to house hunting. Like, real estate agents will almost never immediately show you your ideal home. Like, you'll go to a real estate agent and be like, hey, I need this, this, and this. And they sort of get the picture, right? But they'll purposely not bring you to the ideal home right away because they want you to have some comparison material.
Okay.
So they'll show you like five houses, and then the fifth house is like the one that they know is the one that you really want. Mm-hmm. But you only really appreciate that fifth one because you've seen the other four. And those other four, it's good that you go see them because then you know what's not for you. Because in the beginning, you also don't know exactly, right? You're like, oh yeah, I guess I want a house that has three bedrooms and a bathroom. But you just don't know until you've seen like 10, 20 houses, then you know what you want. But on the other hand, you don't want to get caught up in the process and see 500 houses because then no house is ever going to be perfect. But yeah, so it's a little bit like via negativa, mm-hmm. Where seeing the girls that you don't match with helps you realize which girls you do match with, and it also helps you appreciate it more once you match. It's just you can't overdo it. You can't date 500 women and expect number 501 to be blow the rest out of the water.
Well, yeah, and you can look at it also just as a focus issue. I mean, you can't, your mind isn't actually able to accurately process that many options back to back. And so when guys are doing that, like, you know, when they've dated like 50 plus women, they're like, well, I just need to date more women. It's like, no, you need to pay more attention to what you're doing.
It's the same with house hunting. I mean, if you've seen 50 houses and none of them have been good enough, then maybe you're the problem, not the houses. So it's.
No, absolutely. And it's funny because a lot of the guys, and look, I mean, I get it. Like, it's a defense mechanism, but they'll have these sort of like lists. They'll have all these criteria. And, you know, a lot of times it's just criteria. It's just bullshit that they pulled off Twitter, you know? It's like, oh, this other, Marcus Aurelius account.
Yeah, she needs to be a virgin. She can be tops 18 years old, and she can only wear flower dresses, and she needs to know how to cook 500 different dishes.
Yeah.
This is the minimum, bare minimum.
People who have never been with a woman before putting their it is hilarious. But so you see these lists, and the thing is, when guys get, like, it's important to have standards, but it's also important to know what really matters and what doesn't. And so they'll make this huge list, and I'm like, 90% of this stuff is total bullshit. And probably if you met a woman who had all of it, you wouldn't even like her. Because, you know, a lot of the women that they put that will have all these things, even if they did have all these various traits, they'd probably be so uptight that they wouldn't even be enjoyable to be around. I mean, men really don't, and women as well, right? They don't really know what they want. And with
so this is a story of a friend of mine, and he told me this like almost 10 years ago, and I just never forgot it. And he told me the story about how he got with his girlfriend, who 10 years later he's married to, and he told me, like, oh yeah, first I was dating this other girl, and she was a complete doormat. So I would just be like, hey, what do you want to do? Oh, whatever you want to do. Like, what do you want to eat? Oh, whatever you want to eat. And he's, you know, like on the surface level, that sounds like the ideal for so many guys. Like, oh, you know, whatever you want, she's fine with it. And he said, like, I hated it. I broke up with her after like 2 months because it was literally like I was just like dating this dumbass blow up doll. She had no opinions. She didn't add anything. I got no feedback from her because whatever I did, she was just like, okay, yeah, sure. And that's, you know, a lot of guys think that's the ideal. And then I happened to know a guy who actually found that ideal, and he ran away within 2 months. Mm-hmm. He's like, it was horrible. It's the most horrible dating experience he ever had. And then he met his girlfriend now, which is now his wife. And, you know, she has opinions, and, you know, she's a kitty that needs gloves, but he loves it because at least he can, you know, riff back on her. And still, she's a sweet girl. I've met her a few times. But it's, you know, she has her own opinion. And I think that's important.
I love that you brought that up because this is one of the two big blind spots. The first that guys have, the first isn't in the sexual realm. So they idealize the Madonna, Whereas then they constantly are tormented by the fact that she doesn't have any real sexual energy. And we'll get to that when we move into the sex section. But the other one is exactly what you described, which is this sort of docile, you know, submissive feminine girl. And look, we do want a woman to surrender to us. But if you're actually like a man, do you want really that easy of a conquest?
Yeah, you want to earn it, right? It's like you want her to be submissive, but only because you've earned the right. You know, like you don't, if it's just thrown into your lap, you're just going to be bored by it because there's no sexual tension there. You know, it's just like, okay, she'll do whatever you want. And then, but there's no, you know, it's just like with, if you have one woman where you have to like put in the effort, you take her on 3 dates and then, you know, like build up the tension, everything. And you finally go home together and then you have amazing sex. Or this other woman who just like walks up to you and 5 minutes later you're having sex. It's just the tension isn't there. And like afterwards you're like, what just happened? Like this isn't fulfilling at all. Like just like.
It's boring, but there's also, and I think this is what guys don't get, is that they don't respect the woman.
No. Because I think Picasso once said it perfectly. He said, like, every woman is either a goddess or a doormat.
Yeah. Yeah.
And if she acts like a doormat, that's how you're going to see her. Like, those kinds of relationships will literally end up with you not seeing her at all. Like, she's just there in the kitchen doing her, like, you know, doing the thing, and you don't appreciate any of it. You don't see it after a while. And even though you have the situation where 90% of all men would be like, oh, I would kill someone to have that situation. Like in your mind, you're like halfway out of the relationship. Like either you'll be cheating or you'll be thinking of divorce or whatever. Or you'll be like one of those guys who like gets completely lost in his football hobby or something.
I mean, the woman doesn't have any real energy. That's the issue. There's no energy. And so the guy himself is going to be drawn towards the woman who has more of like a feistiness to her, who has spirit to her. And it doesn't have to be aggressive, but it needs to be spirit. I mean, and this is one of the things, and I think now on the flip side, women do understand this. Some women do understand this. And a lot of the women who are, you know, quote unquote, independent, who have, you know, they're like, well, real men don't want women who they can walk over. And it's like, well, that's true, right? As we just said, but they also don't want women who are incapable of surrendering and who, you know, for them, it's an ego based thing. And so it's really like this between the two points that you want to get to. You want a woman who doesn't surrender to anybody, but is willing to surrender to a guy, and the sort of dance.
I think a point that is adjacent to this is how many guys are always complaining about women never loving them unconditionally.
Yeah,
but I think a relationship where a woman loves you unconditionally, that's the worst thing that can happen to you. Mm-hmm. Because then, you know, like you get fat and you get unemployed. And you get lazy, and she's like, oh, it doesn't matter, honey, it's all okay. You know, like this, you'll just sink further and further. Like we rise or fall to the expectations that are set to us. And if your woman loves you like literally unconditionally, then there's no standard. You know, so then you can fall as deep as you want, and it's still okay. I don't want a woman that loves me unconditionally. I want a woman that has like standards, that just like I have standards. Like I want her to set conditions, like, hey, like if you want me, then you can't just lie on the couch all day, watch TV. You know, like you have to go out and do stuff. You have to have your passions. You have to have, you need to make your, or earn your money. You need to be there for me in this and that way. You know, like I want a woman that has standards. I don't want that doormat. It was just like, okay, whatever you want, honey, it's okay. Oh, you're unemployed. Oh, that's okay. You know, it's like, It's the most horrible relationship you can be in, because like you said, there's no polarity, but then eventually, because there's no polarity coming from her, your own polarity just like drops as well.
It's this is another case of guys not understanding themselves. The whole, like, I want a woman to love me unconditionally is, it's distorted femininity is what they're seeking. They're seeking the dark mother, mm-hmm. which is basically, I mean, they're basically saying that I don't want to be a man. I want to stay in, you know, on mommy's tit for the rest of my life, because going out and having to prove yourself, that is the rite of initiation of being a man. And so, you know, I do think that there's a place, some guys haven't had enough compassion, and they do need some of that feminine energy saying, look, it's okay. You know, you're doing the best you can. It's, and you're okay where you are. But I mean, from a masculine charge standpoint, like, you want the burden of performance. And that's the thing with a lot of these, like, fucking losers, is that they get so bent out of shape about it. It's like, look, you don't have to end up with a bitch or something like that. You know, you don't have to be with someone who treats you with disrespect all the time, but you also want a woman to have standards for you.
I think there's two things there. First, I think a lot of guys just have unrealistic expectations about not expectations, but like an unrealistic view of what the average woman expects. So because they go online and then they read, like, this, you know, you need to be the alpha chat. And then I think every woman has this expectation of you being this super alpha dog that makes like $10 million and has like a 10-inch huge humongous penis that will just fuck her for 4 hours. And that's just ridiculous. You know, like, that's just, this shows that they don't have the experience with like normal, regular women. And secondly, I think it's this thing where just like when you enter the classroom to take your test, you're very tense because you're about to be judged. And the idea of being judged, of being tested, is quite scary, you know, like in the beginning. It's the same with when you're cycling and you hit a stone or something and you fall over your bike. Mm-hmm. That moment before you hit the ground is worse than when you hit the ground, because like in your head it's like, oh shit, it's gonna be horrible, like, oh, it's so much pain, so much, is I'm gonna break everything. And then you fall, you scrape a few things, it hurts a little bit, and you get back up.
Yeah,
I think it's the same thing with a lot of guys that are scared of being held to a certain standard, because it sounds very scary, like, oh, what if I fall short? But I mean, if you're never held to any standards, you can't grow either. So it's just one of those things, like, hey, you know, like, just like the old birdies just fly out of the nest and just like trust that your wings will catch you and you won't fall to the floor. Because otherwise, you know, you're going to be in mommy's nest for the rest of your life.
Yeah. And they use these sort of, so in order to protect themselves, they create these unrealistic expectations of women so that a woman can't meet up to my, you know, made up bullshit fantasy. And as a result, women aren't good enough, but that's just an excuse not to participate. And the funny thing is, if a woman does catch their attention, it's like, you know, they have all these little walls build up, fortifications, and then it's like, oh, this one woman, she like somehow snuck through my defense mechanisms. And then they just, all that need pours out. And it's just the same cycle. And then it's like, all right, next time I'm going to create even more walls and more barriers to... You know,
all these alpha guys online get one cute girl to look into their direction and the entire alpha shtick goes out of the window, and you know, they'll be trembling little boys again, because then suddenly you can't hide behind walls, like you're like faced with reality, and then, you know, like then suddenly the standard is there. Yeah. And then they're like scared as hell because, oh no, I don't want to be held accountable for anything. So it's, you know, it's, but yeah, like you're going to fall short a few times. I mean, I've fallen short many times, been rejected many times, and not just by girls that didn't even know me. Like, I've been rejected by girls that I dated for 3 months and then they were like, nope. Mm-hmm. But it's, you know, that's all part of the process. And every one of those times I learned from it. Did I enjoy it? No. Do I have some bad memories because of it? Yeah, sure. But I mean, without it, I wouldn't be where I am now. So
yeah. I mean, that's why people like you. That's why people resonate with what you say, because it's real. I mean, you actually go out there and you experience.
I've got the scars to prove it.
That's right. That's right. Now, let's talk about attracting a woman versus keeping a woman. What sort of happens in this 3 to 6 month transition point because as the honeymoon phase collapses, what needs to change? What's different long term versus short term?
I think it becomes a, after like the 3 to 6 month mark, it no longer is just about your personal match, like, you know, like your personal chemistry, like, do you two fit together? It also becomes about, do your lives fit together? Because you, like, I'll give an example, another, so I had two friends, which I both knew from work a couple of years back. Guy, girl started dating each other, and he really wanted to have kids, and she didn't. And they were a great, great couple. But, you know, they kept kind of pushing that issue forward until one day it just exploded in their faces. And I think that's the, if you're conscious about dating and if you're smart about it, you cut things off between the 3 and 6 month mark when you realize your lives are just not compatible. You know, like, oh, I want kids, I want a career, I want to travel for 2 years, I want to settle down now. Sometimes you can meet the right woman at the wrong time, and then you have to be willing to let her go. And that's the hardest thing you can do, because, like, in the back of your mind, you're like, oh, maybe I am willing to not have kids, or I can give up everything for her, blah, blah. But then she wouldn't be getting you. She would be getting a very bitter version of you, and you would not be able to keep her either, because, you know, like, not to sound cliche, but if you give up your own dreams and your own mission, then what's left? You know, then you're just her puppy dog. So I think that's one of the major things that changes.
Yeah, there needs to be deeper and deeper levels of self-expression, even though that entails some degree of risk. And so when you have a values discrepancy, I mean, that the self-expression needs to happen. If you have the values discrepancy, you have to walk away. On a compatibility level, let's assume that you have the same values. Mm-hmm. Let's assume that, you know, you might want to write the same things. How do the dynamics change in the relationship? I mean, you mentioned how there's, you know, the techniques don't work like they used to. But what is it that makes a woman say, okay, actually, I'm going to, like what allows her to transition her kind of love for you? Because there's this kind of conception that in order to keep a woman, you have to kind of, you know, you have to keep gaming her. And that's not exactly wrong, depending on what you mean by that. But
yeah, I get what you mean.
A lot of these guys will look at it like it's like you have to literally run game, like if you were trying to. So
like I said, you know, then I guess that's a major transition, is you switch away from game, you know, as a thing, because that works for the first few months, and then she doesn't fall for your bullshit anymore, and then the real you has to come out. So it's kind of like a mask off moment. I think one of I had a client once who had this problem. So he would have no problem attracting women, and they would date 3 months, 6 months, and every time she would break up with him. Mm-hmm. And eventually we got down to the core issue, which was that he kept gaming them, and he refused, you know, like he was scared of letting his mask off. He was scared of showing the real him. So eventually the women get the sense like, hey, he's not being fully honest with me. He's not being very open. Like every time I ask something about him personally, he deflects it, and he comes up with this game technique. Well, of course, he's not thinking that consciously, but it's like, you know, like he weasels his way out. I mean, after a few months, and of course, like I'm a very big fan of showing the real you from the start. But of course, in the beginning, you know, like on the first date, you're going to wear your best outfit. After 5 years, you sit next to each other and you wear your pajamas, right? So it's like you can't keep up the best version of you forever. But you have to transition into showing more of the real you, which of course doesn't mean that suddenly you... It's not like after 6 months you sit her down and you start crying and you tell her all the shit that happened in your past and like all your problems. That's not what happens. It's about her getting to see the lesser sides of you. Like you stop trying to hide everything that you know is like lesser side of you. You know, like in the beginning, like personally, I'm a bit, I call it, I forgot the English word, scatterbrained.
Yeah.
Like I'll put stuff down in places where they don't belong. And then they'll lay there for like 2-3 weeks because I don't even notice I put them there. And then like a certain point, I'm like, oh wait, like my house is a mess again. I need to clean up. Like the first time a girl comes over, I'll clean up my house, you know, like make sure everything's nice. But if I'm dating a girl for 6 months, I'm not cleaning my house yet every time, you know? So eventually she'll start seeing the version where suddenly there's a coffee cup in the bathroom, you know, like in the bathroom sink, because I was just drinking coffee, just left it there. And I forgot about it. You know, like you have to eventually start. And that's a simple example, but eventually she starts seeing the real you. And when she asks you about it, you don't deflect it or something. You're just like, oh yeah, that's who I am. Like, you know, if she sees a coffee cup after 1 month, you just joke about it, like, oh yeah, no, I guess a gnome came out of the cupboard and put it there. If she asks about it after 6 months, you're like, yeah, I'm a bit scatterbrained. You know, that's who I am. I think that's a big transition you have to make. You can't keep bullshitting. You can't be, you know, you can't give her the gnome came out of the cupboard and put it there story 4 years in a row. Like, she'll be like,
yeah, it's exactly that, and it's owning it. And I think one of the issues that guys have, and this is the whole misconception about vulnerability, is that they think being vulnerable is this like dumping emotions on a woman. And the reality is that you can communicate how you're feeling, and you can communicate, you know, acknowledge weaknesses without putting that onto her.
Yeah.
And that's, yeah. This is the big thing. Like, guys can't put it onto her. Like, maybe you get like a pass, like every once in a while, but it's not anything that if you don't do it, then she's there for you. If you do it, then you're turning her into a mother.
Yeah. I think it's just, you know, you always have the extremes, right? Yeah, some guys, you have like, they'll be like, oh yeah, if your mother dies, you can never cry in front of your girlfriend because she'll leave you. And like, you know, if she's going to leave you because you cry because your mother died, then like, get the hell out of there. So that's, you know, that's like the extreme. But it's also, I guess it's the difference. Like, if, let's say you start dating a girl and you run a business, but it's not going too well. You know, you have some financial issues. First month, you're not going to tell her about it. But after 6 months, you can sort of open up about, like, yeah, you know, like, I have a business. It's not going too well. I'm working hard. I'm trying to make it good again. But, you know, I can't promise anything. It might be have to close down my business in a few months. You still don't put that burden on her. It's not like, hey, like, you need to fix this for me, or you need to, like, be the shoulder to cry on. But you can be honest about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you just be honest about it. Like, hey, yeah, my business is not going well. I'm doing the best I can. But, you know, like, I'm not God. I don't know if I'm going to make it or not. So I think that's a switch that a lot of guys are not willing to make. But also a lot of girls. Because don't forget, there's two parties here. And a lot of girls are not mature in this as well. A lot of girls play games, and they'll try to keep playing games. So just like there's a lot of girls that get the sense, like, hey, this guy isn't being honest with me. There's also a lot of guys out there that's like, hey, this girl, something's off about her. And then break up because one or both are not willing to open up in that way and just keep facade.
Really glad you mentioned that. I mean, one of the things, and I'm seeing it more and more, is women are blowing up relationships left and right. And I think, you know, a lot of the stuff that guys in the red pill ascribe to, you know, hypergamy or whatever, is really just anxiety. Mm-hmm. I mean, a girl, she can like a guy and things are going well, but then she has big self-esteem issues and she's getting anxious about the fact that things are developing, and she's getting anxious about the guy seeing more of who she is. And then so she blows it up. She disappears. She runs away from it, you know, and they're like, oh, well, she wanted to go out and bang Chad. It's like, well, actually, that was probably, assuming she even did that, that's, like, safer for her emotionally. Yes.
A lot of people have self-destructive behaviors. You can't always blame yourself for it. You know, it's just, there's only so much you can do. And sometimes it's just that you two don't match well enough. You know, then it's just, and that sucks because you do want it to match because you do like her. But if you're honest with yourself, you do see things about her that you're like, you know, 3 years from now, it's going to annoy the hell out of me. And it just doesn't work.
Yeah. It's, one of the things that's interesting with serious relationships, though, is trauma bonds or these sort of karmic dynamics. So it's like you get drawn to something that she does, even though it's negative because of your own experience with it. And it's interesting in those relationships whether or not, you know, whether or not they're going to go to distance. But at the very least, I've noticed that you have to, like, you're being drawn to that for a reason. So even if there's a lot of, like, negative elements, it's kind of like you need to get over this shit. And that's why you're dating this person, because, you know, I'll give an example of my own relationship. I mean, my wife's got some fire to her. And my mom, when she was younger, she was, you know, she was a great mother. But, I mean, when I was much younger, she had these anger outbursts. And so I didn't realize to what extent I would get, like, really triggered by, you know, displays of anger. It was like, and that became, that was a huge impediment. Like, it created a whole cycle in the relationship for a while that we really had to, like, dissect, you know, on her end, why she was, you know, jumping to that direction and why I was taking it personally, even when it had nothing to do with me.
Mm.
And it wasn't until we unwound that the relationship really started to get good. It's like we had, like, the amazing honeymoon phase, and then it's like we started to go down to this depth where that pattern was just capturing stuff. And then it's like, okay, now, like, we've transcended the pattern. You know, it doesn't mean that it doesn't, like, the emotion doesn't come up sometimes, but you know what I mean?
It's very hard to 100% eliminate patterns of behavior that you taught yourself or someone else taught you as a kid. But just being aware of them is huge, because most people are totally not aware of the patterns that they go through. And most of this, so to tie in the hypnosis thing, most patterns in humans are built somewhere between the ages of 0 and 12, most of them even between the ages of 0 and 7. So by the time you're 7, you have your defense mechanisms, you have your ways of coping with things, and then you'll see people are 80 years old and they still have the exact same coping and defense mechanisms that they had when they were 7 years old. You know, like, some kids will become very conflict avoidant, you know, like, so for instance, they had this one time when they were 4, and, like, their parents are, like, really, like, super angry at them, and they just retreated to their room, started crying, and then, so that's their defense mechanism. And others start eating, for instance, and others again become very angry, and they get anger management issues for the rest of their lives. So it's just knowing these things, that's, like, half the battle, because most people don't even realize that they're getting angry because they have this defense mechanism, and they'll blow up all their relationships because, you know, they just get angry, and then when someone says something about it, they'll get even angrier. And a lot of relationships have toxic or trauma bonding, and I think especially guys are very vulnerable for this because, well, also a certain type of woman, but, you know, we always get this savior complex. You see a girl who's, because damaged girls, they are vulnerable. So, and then we want to help them, we want to save them. And we feel attracted to them in a certain way. And also it creates polarity and creates sexual tension.
Yes.
But it's a very unhealthy, like, it's a very unhealthy dynamic that you never really want to be a part of, ever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, things only get better in those dynamics when both parties take responsibility for their, you know, for their actions and, you know, reactions to their responses. Because then it's like, okay, yeah, maybe, like, I'm taking responsibility for getting, you know, the fact that I was getting angry. I shouldn't have been doing that? Why was I doing that? And then take responsibility. Okay, I was triggered by it. Why am I? It's not like you don't put it on the other person. Like, you make me feel bad because you do this, or, you know, you invalidate me when I have an emotion. But the thing with what you're describing is that very often neither party has any awareness, or then only one does. And that's usually when the relationship ends, when one party has awareness and the other one doesn't. Mm-hmm. And if the other party won't become aware. But when you're going to save a woman, like, guys don't even, they don't take, like, they keep thinking that they can fix it. And the reality is that they can't fix it. Only she can fix it. You can hold space for her to help deal with her problems. But if she's not going to take responsibility to deal with it, there is zero chance of it succeeding. And the flip side is, like, when these guys will leave, then the woman wants to, you know, change things. And you have to be very suspicious of that too, because it's usually just, you know, a tactical maneuver. Yeah, on her, keep the guy.
What makes those relationships even worse is that it's not just that she doesn't want to change, it's that she'll start blaming all her faults on you.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, then you get, like, these crazy situations where, like, no, I went through your phone because you're not trustworthy. I cheated on you because you weren't providing me with, you know, and those are, like, the super toxic women. Yeah. You know, the ones that the red pill always pretends that all the women are like that. I mean, they do exist, definitely. Sure. But those kinds of relationships, like, if she has zero self-awareness, actually wrote an article, email article about this the other day, because I was watching, you know, like, sometimes before I go to bed or something, when I'm not in the mood to do anything, I'll watch these horrible dating shows. It's like one of my guilty pleasures. And there was this show on Netflix, which is a terrible show, don't watch it. It's called The Ultimatum. And it was about these couples. And the premise of the show was there were six couples all on the show. And in every six couples, one person had issued an ultimatum. Like, either you marry me or we split up. So what they would do is they would relate to the people. So everyone would go on speed dates with the other people from the other couples to see if there was other matches. And then if there was a match, you would, like, pick each other, live together for 3 weeks to look at, like, what a different relationship would look like. And then afterwards you go back to your original relationship and see if, like, something changed. And that's where you really saw those dynamics in action, because I have to say, like, most of the ultimatums were issued by the women, but also you saw, I guess I'd say, like, four out of six guys were willing to do the introspection, about, like, two or three out of six girls.
Yeah.
But then you saw, like, some of those arguments they got into, where one of the two just was not willing to do any introspection whatsoever. And then you, like, immediately, I wrote down some of the toxic traits. So you, first of all, you get the deflection, you know, like, you just, whenever someone says something negative about you, you deflect in a certain way. So either they start talking about your tone. That's a huge red flag. Like, if I'm like, hey, Pat, you really need to stop going through my phone because, you know, like, it's very annoying. And you're like, oh, don't put that phone tone on me. Like, why are you so angry? Like, it's a huge red flag, because that person is zero introspection, just trying to blame you, and the behavior only get worse. Like, alternatively, you know, like, using sex, you know, like, I won't use the same example because it's a bit weird, but, like, if you go to your wife and you're like, hey, why are you doing this? And she says, like, oh, here are my boobs, let's have sex. It's a horrible deflection. So, you know, like, you can spot the signs, like deflection. But also an interesting one was, and this was this one guy. Like, sometimes they have guys you can just tell they're good at sex. Like, you could tell he was good at sex. And he was a horrible person. Like, well, he's not, like, a horrible person, but he was, like, horrible to his girlfriend. Like, he just knew, he just, like, strung along. And she just accepted all of it because, you know, like, the sex was amazing. She was just addicted. So there's many forms of toxic relationships. And you can probably tell I'm a bit scatterbrained because I'm trying to get to my point now, but I'm taking all these sight reads.
Yeah, this is good. There's a lot of really good stuff coming out here. Do you have anything else you want to add? Because I actually have a good question here.
Well, it's just to finish it up. So there's many ways you can be toxic. But you have to be introspective. So you did see some of these people come out, and you could tell, and of course it's all scripted and everything's fake, but you could tell that within like 6 weeks, they'd become a different person, because getting into that other relationship and then getting back in their own relationship, you could tell they grew and they learned. And for instance, this one girl, I think she was called Shanique, at the beginning, zero introspection, horrible. Like she really did, like, don't put that tone on me, blah, blah. And in the end, she was, you know, like, they had like a recap. And she was like, yeah, no, I made so many mistakes in the past. I'm so lucky you're still with me. And like, I'm so happy, blah, blah, blah. And you could tell, like, they both of them had grown. So that literally, it can go that fast. Like, once both of you are willing to say, like, okay, we're tired of toxicity, now we're going to grow together, a matter of weeks. And didn't even have a therapist or whatever. Just like two people being honest, being open, be like, okay, we're both imperfect, let's listen to each other. Like, their relationship changed in like a matter of 3 or 4 weeks.
The ego had the drop, basically.
Yeah. And
everything came into place. It's interesting, you know, you would think that like super degen thing like that would have, you know, but it's interesting how just having, like, it actually brought them closer together in the end and gave them that introspection. But I do want to get to sex, because you're known as, you know, the erotic hypnotist. So I want to talk to me a bit. You know, you mentioned this guy, you could just tell he was good at sex. Well, so what does that look like? What does that mean? How do you know if a guy is...
In this case, I think he's like 6'5", probably a basketball player. And he's had that swagger. You could just tell, you know, like, he had that confidence. You know, some people call it big dick energy or whatever.
Yeah.
But it's not about the size of your penis. It's about just knowing. You know, like, when a guy knows he's good at sex, and not like delusionally, but like, he just generally knows, you know, it's just, they just have this air around him. You can tell. It's like, yeah, okay, this guy knows. Yeah, but it's just, yeah, how can you tell? It's just, I think it's, you know, it's like a feedback loop. If everyone always tells you you're pretty, then eventually you go walk around the street like, oh yeah, I'm pretty. And like, if every girl you've ever been with has always kept coming back for more because the sex was so good, then eventually you start walking around the street like, yeah, I'm the man. And other girls can tell.
What is it that makes a man good in bed? How do you get to be good in bed? Is it something that any guy can do?
To a certain degree, of course. I mean, I think sex is, you know, like let's compare it to marathon running. And anyone, pretty much anyone with training can run a marathon. But very, you know, and then there's degrees. Some people can do it in 4 hours, some in three, some in two. And of course, you're always going to have people who are just like natural at it, and people who, even if they train very hard, they're only okay at it. But I think anyone can get good at it, unless you have like legit physical problems. You can, everyone can get good at it. Mm-hmm. But it's just, I think, and one of the main parts of that is just stop comparing yourself to these imaginary porn actors or Chads or whatever, because there's not that many guys out there who are naturally like amazing at sex. I mean, of course they exist, but it's like maybe 1 in 1,000 or something.
Yeah.
It's rare. And guys also vastly overestimate how long other men last. Like, yeah. I think there's like research about this, like the average man lasts like 7 minutes. So it's like, you know, like the competition isn't that strong. Like, literally, if you can last 10 minutes, like, you're above average.
Yeah.
So it's, I mean, I think it's sex is mostly a mental game. Because let's say like if you do it properly, like if you go on a date, for instance, the sex sort of starts as soon as the date starts, right? Like, the tension's building, passion, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And the sex itself doesn't even have to last that long. You know, like, you go on a date for a full night, you know, pick her up at 8, bring her home at 2 a.m. So it's like 6 hours. The sex itself, what, maybe like 20 minutes. So that's only like a small part, but that's the part everyone focuses on. Everyone's like, oh no, I need to do this perfectly. where it's like, yeah, but there's like this huge part in front of it, and there's also quite a bit afterwards.
Yeah.
Like, if you focus on that, then you're already, because nobody else does that. You know, like most guys, it's like, okay, bam, bam, thank you, ma'am, and they're gone. Whereas like the 30 minutes, 1 hour after sex is, it's kind of like a magical time where that's when you really bond. And even if the sex wasn't super amazing, I mean, like, granted, it wasn't terribly bad. It's just a moment to bond, you know, like, it's just, and also beforehand, like, you know, like, foreplay is a dirty word in the masculine dictionary, but it can actually be a lot of fun because, you know, and guys also have this very physical, limited idea of foreplay. This is like foreplay. Oh yeah, I'll lick her pussy for 5 minutes. That's foreplay. But that's not what foreplay is about. You know, foreplay is about building the tension, the passion, the making her feel desired, making her feel wanted by you, you know, like showing your own masculine desire and then having her reciprocate that, her also showing her feminine desire for you. So I think if you do those things, even if you don't change your like sex itself game, already makes you stand out. So yeah, like every guy can get good at it. And also the sex part itself, you can learn all the things. But it's just that most guys, and I also blame pornography for a part, but most guys just think of it as such a physical thing. Whereas sex is 90% mental and emotional. And that's also what you learn with erotic hypnosis.
Yeah, so jump into that for a second. I mean, is erotic hypnosis something that you can do with any woman? Do you think that it works on every woman? And is it something that you have to, or that you should introduce early on or bring it in later on?
I think, so first of all, it's not this sort of magical alien thing that is completely different from everything that you're doing now. It's just a better version of the mental game.
Okay.
That's with sex. So yes, you can do it with every woman, but also it's such a broad thing. Like, you can't do every part of erotic hypnosis with every woman. Like, some women are open to certain things, others are open to other things. But I mean, every woman is open to, you know, introducing words into the bedroom, right? Mm-hmm. Like I don't know a single woman who just wants you to be quiet for like 2 hours and just purely physical, say nothing and just like awkward.
Yeah.
So just knowing the right things to say can already be very erotic, very hypnotic as well. I mean, hypnosis is mostly just words. So the difference between good hypnosis, bad hypnosis is how do you string which words along in what kind of way. And also, I mean, women have great imagination. So erotic hypnosis is a lot about tapping into that imagination, you know, tapping into that fantasy. And you can also do it with men as well. It's just like, I've never specialized in that, but you can do it as well. It's just that men are just a little bit more physical, I guess. So, you know, if a woman describes her fantasy to you, she'll give you more of a setting, you know, like, oh, this romantic prince that, you know, has certain characteristics, and he takes her on this journey, this adventure, and they do things, and then stuff just happens and it just gets romantic. Whereas if you ask a guy for his fantasy, he's like, yeah, two girls, one has big tits and the other one's Asian. And you're like, it's a very physical thing. It's not, they're not, you know, like, you never get a guy who's like, oh yeah, you know, then this cute girl and I meet her at the record shop and she's like instantly into me. And that's way more, so that's a very masculine thing, is just to be like, oh yeah, titties. Whereas women want a story. And that's what hypnosis is about. It's about telling good stories. So in that way, it is very powerful. It does work with every woman, as long as they're open to it. I mean, some guys have this weird notion where you just learn hypnosis, and you go on the street, be like, and then and she's in love with you. That's not how it works. But if you're dating a woman, I think you should introduce it from the start. Not even like the because you can do it in a more technical way and just go way further with it than most guys ever will. But you do need to start from the, you know, from the start. You need to implement talking, creating these little stories with her. Because I mean, if women fantasize about these romantic stories with the prince and the horse and stuff, then the best thing you can do is to become the prince and the horse and stuff, right? So you become that guy that takes them on the adventure. You become the guy who just meets her at a bar and then swoops her away, and you just go into this magical adventure that lasts throughout the night, and you end up, you know, gazing at the stars in the park, and then stuff just happens, and you start kissing, and it's oh so magical. So erotic hypnosis is way more common than guys think. But it's just, you know, it's just like bad patterns. People just don't know what they're doing or why they're doing it. And I guess once you get into erotic hypnosis, you start analyzing, like, hey, okay, so this is what this is what's actually happening. And then, of course, then you get like the technical side where it's like, okay, I can actually learn these techniques where, for instance, you can anchor orgasms. So, you can do really extreme weird stuff. You can just like boop her nose and she comes, you know, like, because you can train, that's how the human body works. You can train, or you could have her really live out her fantasies, because if it knows you go, you know, it's kind of like watching a really good movie, you get sucked into it, but then the movie is happening inside your own head. So you can sort of make her fantasies come true by guiding her through her fantasies. So they don't even have to happen, but they'll happen inside her head. And then of course she'll get very aroused.
So erotic hypnosis, you would say it's mostly used in the context to put a woman into a fantasy state and then get her aroused from there, or can you use it to like, in, is there a more subtle way to use it that's more just between the two of you?
I mean, you can actually sit her down and really hypnotize her and just go, go through the motions, and you can create your own stories together. I don't know, have you ever been hypnotized or?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah, okay. So you can just like hypnotherapy, whatever, you can just go through an entire session. Only, for instance, you anchor certain emotions, or you can teach her certain things. There's some very easy to learn powerful techniques, like creating a ball of light inside her. That's just like pure arousal, and teach her how to move that ball throughout her own body, for instance. And then those are things you can do between the two of you and make it very intimate, because then you can, for instance, you can link it to yourself as well. You can like, whenever I do X and Y, then Z happens inside your body, or you will start thinking about, or you will feel this, or so you can make it very personal. You can even take it to the extreme, which I always advise against, and also never ever teach anyone, but you can take it to such an extreme where you are the only one that she can feel aroused with.
Yeah.
Because you can train her in such a way that, but then, you know, I'm not going to go further in this, because there's always this one guy who's like, okay, teach me how, I'm not going to, but for many reasons, not just the ethical ones, it's a very horrible situation that you don't want to be in. But that's how far you can take it. And she can literally only feel pleasure when you're there or when you're doing certain things. So that's how powerful it is. But of course, you don't want to take it to that extreme. You want to be in the sweet spot where you're doing this together and she feels these things because you're doing them with them, with her.
Uh-huh.
But at the same time, it's not an obligation, or it's not, you never want to use it as like a power technique to be like, oh, you can't never leave me because, you know. But yeah, I mean, I'm not being very coherent here, but it's very,
I understand.
It's extremely powerful.
I understand that, and I know what you're talking about. I mean, you don't want to take it to that level, especially from, you know, for the people who are going to watch this and are, you know, going to go crazy with that. Because give them a sense of control, it's a breach of the trust.
I made a course about this, and I think the first lesson is about like, get rid of those ideas, because it's not about control. It's not about taking it, because you won't have to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like when you open a candy store, you don't have to make people, you don't have to force people to come in and buy. They come in themselves because they want to be there, you know, because they want to have a lollipop, or they want to have something nice and sweet. There's no need to put heroin in your candies just to force them to come back or something. And that's there's always these guys who want to take it to that level. It's like, you know, like, grow some confidence, you know, just realize that it's good enough, you know, like you don't have to take it that far, because then, you know, like once you start putting heroin into the candies, then you get like crazy sex addicts coming after you, like
right.
Because
they
yeah,
think
like
you want, but
you think you want it, but you don't want a woman that goes full on crazy, because if you leave her, she'll never be able to feel pleasure again. Like you don't want that crazy, because yeah. that's the kind of crazy that like stands in front of your door all night because she thinks there's another guy, another girl with you.
Yeah.
Even if you're just trying to get some sleep, you know, like you just don't want to take it there. And then of course there's the huge ethical reasons why you don't want to take it there either. So here's
a question. So a lot of guys who are, you know, listening to this, obviously they're getting really excited. They want to learn it. And by the way, your course is awesome. Remember, I got it
Thank
a few
you.
Years back when it came out, and the link for that is going to be beneath here when we post the video, so you guys can get it. But one of the things, it's one thing, like when you're in the honeymoon phase, you get a lot of support to kind of go into this stuff, because if you're running pretty good game in general, she's already going to be disposed to fall into sort of a fantasy state. So you can introduce this stuff, you can set things up right. What about for the guys who have been in relationships for a long time? They're past that. They're, as we talked about earlier, you know, there's not really any kind of bullshit. You can't just bullshit. So how do those guys move into this if, let's say, the relationship, I'm not saying it's bad, but let's just say it's not, she's not like totally sexually open within the relationship itself. How can guys move down this trajectory?
I think there's two major barriers why a woman would not want to do it with you. One is she doesn't know what hypnosis is, and she thinks it's like this crazy, scary thing where it's like mind control. Or two, she's just not open to do it with you. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, if it's the first one, then it's mostly just about, you know, explaining what it is. And then I think I have something in my course about that, where you can introduce hypnosis without really introducing it, because the label hypnosis is such a big one. Whereas a lot of things that hypnosis does are things that you do every day. Like if you go on your phone and stare at your screen for like half an hour, like you like look up, you're like, hey, wait, where did the time go? And just spent like half an hour scrolling on Twitter. That's hypnosis as well. That's a form of hypnosis. So taking that fear away, it's not that difficult. You know, you just go watch some YouTube videos together on how hypnosis works. And if she's not willing to do it with you, then you know, then you need to work on your relationship first. You need to ask yourself, why is my girlfriend, my wife, not willing to explore parts of her sexuality with me, new parts of her sexuality? Is it because she's afraid? Because, you know, some women are afraid of exploring their own sexuality. Is it because she just, you know, like, I just don't evoke it inside her, like I don't stir her loins anymore? Mm-hmm. You know, like, you need to find out what the reason is, and then you can start working on it. So, you know, of course, I would be a good salesman if I'm like, oh, yeah, no, whatever's the problem, you can always just buy my course and, like, it will be fixed. But it's not true. Like, if she's not open to it, then, you know, it's not like some sort of magic spell that you wear her. It's something that you do together. And it's like persuasion. Like, I can, if you're not open to listen to me, then I can try whatever I want, but I'll never persuade you to do anything. Like, you have to be open and willing to listen to me before that happens. You have to be sexually open to try something new and explore together to be willing to try erotic hypnosis. And it's a lot of trust as well, because it is, it's not scary. It's a very safe thing. Nothing can happen. But for women, the first time it happens, it's often very scary. You know, it's like, oh, like it's all these new sensations, and what's going to happen with me? And like, oh, he touched me and suddenly I feel things that I've never felt before. And so, yeah, like work on trust, work on bringing passion back, or maybe just like literally just sit down, like having this conversation, like, hey, like our relationship is getting still. Do you want to try this out with me? Mm-hmm. You know, like, so yeah, it's, I mean, it can work. I mean, it definitely works with relationships that have been longer together longer, but it does have the condition that she needs to be open to it. So don't buy the course before having the conversation with your girlfriend or wife, whether she would be open to it, because otherwise you're buying it for nothing. Because there's no secret trick in the course that will convince her.
So jumping off of that, because I know that like in a lot of, when I see it all the time with clients, like in serious relationships, you have, there is maybe a level of, like it's, maybe she's not as excited by you as she was in the beginning, and, you know, diagnosing the reasons for that, right? A lot of times it comes down to like the guy's own sort of neediness around sex. Mm-hmm. But one thing that I don't think does get enough attention is that a lot of women really are scared by their own sexuality. And I also say this, I think this is really interesting, because I've seen this with guys who have kids, that there's, when a woman becomes a mother, there's also like an archetypal kind of switch that can sometimes occur in them. And so, and I think, you know, the Red Pill talks about how a woman, as she gets, oh, well, she did this in college, but she's not going to do it. But there, it's not as personal as people necessarily want to take it. There's a level of how the woman views herself, and she can start to become afraid or threatened by her own sexual nature in terms of how it might affect other things in terms of how she is and how she needs to be. Like, she doesn't know how to kind of compartmentalize and exist in these different roles. So when a woman has like her own fear around being more sexually open, what can you do to get her to be more sexually open without, because, you know, one of the difficulties is a guy will try to get her to be more sexually open, but then he puts pressure on her and then she shuts down. So how do you do that?
I think that's mostly a trust-based thing. So also with my therapy work, I have come across this issue as well, and also from the female, like the woman's perspective. I think, I don't have any statistics to back this up, but I think one of the main reasons, mental reasons, why women are unable to have an orgasm is because an orgasm is a sort of surrendering. You know, like you surrender yourself to your partner, to your own body, to your own mind, whatever. So you surrender yourself. You lose control for a moment. You know, like you can't stop your orgasm halfway through, be like, oh, no, whatever. Like I changed my heart. I'm not going to have this orgasm. No, like you're into the roller coaster and it's going to happen. And I guess for guys, this isn't really as much of an issue because, you know, like the male orgasm is what, like 5 to 10 seconds. Whereas a woman's orgasm, I guess it's like starts at 15 seconds and then it goes up to, well, it can go up to like for minutes, especially if you know erotic hypnosis, then you can learn how to give her sort of this like
cascade
of orgasms that can last like half an hour. So it's way more vulnerable, I guess. And once she's in that mode, I don't want to say you have control over her, but you kind of do. Like, it's not like you control her, but you do. You are in charge of that. You know, like you are the one that's giving it to her. And once it's going, she can't really stop it herself because, you know, it just feels too good. Like, it's, you know, it's like one of those things where it's very hard to stop it yourself. So she needs to trust you. And it's very important. I mean, it's so important that I would say, like, it's the top three is just trust. And I know I sound like a typical therapist right now, but if she doesn't trust you, find out why. Like, why does she not trust you with her sexuality? Is it because your own sexuality is underdeveloped? Is it because you don't trust her as well? Like, are you also holding back? And trust is not just about being vulnerable. It's also about, you know, like crazy example, let's say I have a huge cowboy fetish and I would love nothing more than my girlfriend to wear a cowboy hat during sex. But I know the chances of her just mocking me and thinking it's ridiculous are big. Then I'm going to close up myself as well. Mm-hmm. So you can also ask yourself, like, hey, if she's unwilling to share her sexual fantasies, if she's unwilling to try out these things with me, then that's because, just like me in my cowboy hat, she thinks that you're going to mock her. You know, like, and women can have some pretty wild fantasies, and a lot of guys do judge him for it. And then, you know, like, women close up, like, in your relationship, you need to ask yourself, like, let's say she says something wild, like, she says, like, oh yeah, my fantasy is to have sex with four guys at the same time. Would you be ready to hear that? Like, would you be able to hear it? And would you be really, like, able to process that without being like, oh, you dirty hoe? You know, because that's the first response a lot of guys would have. But that's also the reason why she doesn't open up to you, because she knows that's how you're going to respond. So, you know, like that trust requires vulnerability, and that you're going to have to, like, sit through it and listen to it and accept it and not judge it. And that's something most guys can't do. And that's something women sense. Women know, even if they've been with their husband for 10 years, they know what they can and cannot say in front of him, or can or cannot do. Yeah. Because a lot of guys would be like, oh yeah, I really want my woman to open up fully sexually. But then, you know, like, would you still be cool with it if she wants to lick your penis after you've put it in her ass or something, like, raw? Like, would you still be, because, you know, like, that might be her fantasy. And then a lot of guys would be like, oh, no, I would be disgusted. Like, I would never look at my wife the same way. I'm like, yeah, but that's why she doesn't open up. So, yeah, I think that's one of the main reasons. Pretty much that's the only reason, apart from maybe you just don't radiate any sexual energy yourself. Like, if you don't show any tension yourself, you don't open up yourself, you don't, then, yeah, like, you know, like, I also don't get aroused looking at lampposts, because there's no sexuality in lampposts. So, you know.
So that's a good question. That's a good segue. I mean, I'll just say this real quick. With she can be very afraid of your own reaction to it. But I think there's also the element of shame herself. You know, she has that fantasy. Yeah. She doesn't even want, it's not even that she necessarily thinks that you're going to judge her. It's that she judges herself for even having it, doesn't want it to even be released.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, totally. And then you have to think, like, okay, sure, there's a few things which I guess more of like a nature level cause us to feel shame. You know, like, there are some fantasies out there that is very deep and dark, and you did, like, it comes from a very dark spot somewhere in your own mind that brings up these fantasies, and you consciously don't even want it, but it's like this thing just keeps coming back up. But most fantasies, she'll feel ashamed about it because society tells her to feel ashamed about her sexuality. You know, like, all her life she's learned that, you know, like, oh, if you wear this top, you're a slut. If you show these, if you're too easy with men, you're a slut. If you show that you want to have a threesome with two guys, you're a slut. Then, of course, yeah, you know, like, she knows that if she goes on the public town square and she's like, oh, these are my fantasies, that everyone's going to be like, oh, you're a slut. And I think that's where the shame comes from. It's the shame isn't that much internal, unless, like, one of those dark fantasies where you're like, oh, like if it's like, oh, I want to have sex with a corpse or something, then it's like, yeah, like, you know, that's not a healthy thought to have. But most of these fantasies are just, she's ashamed because other people tell her to be ashamed. And you need to show her that she doesn't have to be ashamed, and that she could be open about it with you. And also, you don't have to start with the extreme things. You can start by opening up to smaller things. And that's some, you know, that's a great way to be vulnerable. You know, this is a way a man can actually be vulnerable instead of just crying, is open up about smaller fantasies that you have. You know, they tell her about the cowboy hat. Mm-hmm. And then if she knows that you're willing to be vulnerable with her and you try out the cowboy hat thing, then afterwards you can also ask her, like, hey, are there also things that you might want to try out? And then she doesn't have to come up with her extreme fantasies right away, but she can do the smaller things. And also, if she starts laughing about your cowboy hat idea, then don't immediately feel insulted or rejected, but ask yourself, like, hey, why are we in the situation where she would laugh at me instead of being open to it?
Right.
I mean, unless your fantasy is totally ridiculous, and often it's just her also being very restricted, very scared of sexual fantasies and sexual tension.
Yeah, how you respond to it also, you know, she might, even if she doesn't respond properly the first time, how you respond to her response stops the cycle. Like, she might have that response, and then she'll be like, she might laugh, and then she'll be like, okay, you know. Just get, like, go like that.
Small addendum here. I think it's also because the way guys introduce fantasies, right? Because often guys will, you know, they'll date a girl for 3 months, and now they'll be like, hey, I want to do anal. And, you know, like, maybe a little bit more subtle. But that's, you know, like, their idea of introducing fantasies, just be like, hey, I want to do anal, I want to do a threesome. And they're just, like, testing, like, hey, what would you be open for?
It's ego. A lot of it's ego. Yeah.
And they never really wonder, like, hey, but what's in it for her? Like, what would she want to do? Like, why would she want to try anal with me? Why would she want to have a threesome with me? Like, why would she do any of these things? And because guys never ask that question, then she's just going to close off, because she's like, you know, because in her back of her mind, she just sees this image of him not caring and just wanting to do anal and just trying to go at it like a porn star and just hurting her.
Yeah, it either comes from the position of ego, like they just want to tell themselves that they're the man because they did it. She did what they said, which is, you know, not real leadership. But I think the other part of it is that it can come from sort of like a pornographic lust, which is different than like a genuine kind of desire. Like, I want to experience this with you. Like, it objectifies her. And it's not that women don't want to be viewed as a sexual object, but it's like a dissociation. And so some women are okay with doing that, but it's also their own kind of coping mechanism. It's a performance based kind of thing. So it's like, I want you to play out this sort of role. And there's so many little subtleties here that unless you're both kind of like consciously agreeing to play out the role, what happens is it becomes some sort of like, I want you to, like, I don't really want you, I just want you to be this thing.
Yeah, so like what you said, the last one is very good. I think if you want to do a fantasy, you have to ask yourself two questions. So first, do I just want to do the fantasy, or do I want to do the fantasy with her? And those are big differences. Like, do I just want to have anal sex so I can say I've had anal sex? Or is this something I want to experience specifically with her because it's a fantasy for us together? And I think the second thing is you have to ask yourself, if I could never, ever tell anyone about what we just did, would it still be as appealing to me?
Yeah.
Like, do you want to have the threesome, or do you just want to be able to go into a bar and be like, hey, I had a threesome, to all your friends? Because a lot of guys, it's going to be the second one, because once they really start thinking about the threesome, and once it gets closer and they realize, like, oh, hey, like, now I have two women I need to please, and like one woman is already difficult, like, oh, and suddenly they start getting scared and it's not that fun anymore. And the entire time they're just stuck in their head and they don't know what to do. And because they don't really want the fantasy, they want to just be able to say they did the fantasy.
Yes.
You know, like, and if that's the only reason why you do it, then just, you know, just lie about it. Just tell people you did it anyhow, because what's the difference?
Mm-hmm. Huge point there. You know, it's interesting. I am going to be interviewing Mark Darien later today, which I think is going to be awesome. But one of the things, he has a video, he talks about fetishes, and I think it's kind of similar to this. And he breaks it into this kind of quadrant thing where you have the compulsiveness of the sort of fetish fantasy, and then you have whether it comes from joy or from shame. And that was really interesting, you know, to hear it come from a position of joy, because we don't usually think of it like that. But it could be, you know, you were dating a girl and she wore a certain skirt and you had a massive crush on her. And so when a girl wears, you know, this particular type of skirt, you know, plaid skirt, let's just say schoolgirl skirt, it really turns you on, because it's associated with this sort of positive memory. And so it's like, if it's not compulsive and it's comes from a position of joy, there's really nothing wrong with it at all to experience. It's more of like a preference. Whereas if it's compulsive and it comes from shame, then, you know, that's probably something that you want to, that that you want to investigate, where, you know, the other two quadrants kind of being like ambiguous, dependent.
I think even in even if the reason comes from a bad place, then the fantasy can still be healing. Sometimes, like stuff might have happened in real life, and then getting to play out the same sort of stuff in a fantasy setting can be helpful. Mm-hmm. But it just has to be, it can never be about, I'll give an example. For instance, rape fantasies.
Yeah, I was hoping you were going to do that one.
So rape fantasies can actually be derived from a woman actually having been raped in the past.
Yeah.
And I know what I'm going to say now is controversial, but, you know, this, like, disclaimer, this, I'm not talking about all women, blah, blah, blah. It's just that some women that have been raped.
It's well documented. I mean, people.
Yeah. Afterwards, they develop rape fantasies. Yeah. And then going through such a fantasy with the right man, who will give her the trust, the safety, and the emotional support that she needs, can be a very healing experience for a woman. Mm-hmm. But it has to be for the right man, mm-hmm. and it has to be for the right reasons. So, you know, like, and then, so even if it comes from a place of pain, it can be very healing. But it's risky. You know, it's like if you have that rape fantasy and then during the fantasy you experience very negative things, then you can just kind of like amplify the trauma. But it is possible.
Well, you know, I think what you're saying is a lot of people have to get that this is a really, really conscious choice that would be acted out between the two people with an intention behind it. Mm-hmm. The reality is that a lot of the women who have been sexually abused and who have these fantasies acted out unconsciously, which is why, you know, women who are hyper promiscuous are, there's a high correlation of sexual abuse, mm-hmm. with promiscuous women. It's a very unconscious pattern that they,
it's taking back control of your sexuality unconsciously, because, yeah. the power to decide who you have sex with was taken away from you. So now you want to like decide as many times as often who you're going to have sex with, so you can really feel like you have that power back. But of course, it's a very unhealthy coping, yeah. mechanism.
Yeah, it's continually re-abuses you in a certain sense. So yeah, what you're talking about is something very, very advanced. And just to kind of bring it back to your key point before, it all comes down to trust.
Yeah. Being,
and I know one of the things, just like almost bringing it full circle, in the beginning stages of a relationship, there's so much fantasy and there's so much novelty that obviously, like, you know, there needs to be a level of trust, but there's also a level of suspended, you know, disbelief. It's kind of like you're existing in this other reality. Like, it's one of the reasons
you're in the bubble together.
Yeah, and it's one of the reasons why, even sometimes with one night stands, girls will do some crazy stuff because they're not going to see you again. You know, it's kind of like in that moment, it's like they can trust the anonymity and the lack, like they can be vulnerable with you because they don't need to be associated with you.
I think what you hit on there is it goes way deeper. You know, like you always have the oh yeah, like, oh, she's married to the beta husband, but she wants to have sex with the alpha Chad. I think a large part of it is not having to fear judgment in a one-night stand, because you're both a little bit drunk, you're both down to go crazy, and she doesn't have to fear your judgment because she'll never see you again.
Yeah.
So you, like, even afterwards, you might think like, whoa, this girl, she was like off of her mind, she was crazy, but it doesn't reflect on her. Like, she doesn't have to face that. Whereas if she tries those things with her husband, and her husband's like, whoa, girl, you're crazy, then she has to face the judgment, she has to face the rejection. And I think that for a large part explains this, you know, like, oh, alpha fox, beta box thing. It's not that they don't want to do these things with their husbands. I mean, granted that they actually care about their husband, love their husband, not some sort of weird convenience marriage.
Sure.
It's not that they don't want to do it with their husband. It's just that they fear the judgment. But then this exciting guy comes by, and they don't have to care about, you know, like the aftermath, you know, like, oh, she goes to Congress, sleeps with this exciting guy, and, you know, she gets to live out her fantasy, which she would have wanted to do with her husband as well. But yeah, her husband's going to judge her, and this guy doesn't. So I think that, you know, like, because you hit on that point, that's a very important part of it, why women seem to go for the exciting bad boys. It's just because, you know, like, a one-night stand is a sort of escape card, get out of jail card. You get no guilt, you get no shame, you get none of those things.
Yeah, I mean, I've always broken down attraction to desire and comfort, and these sort of, like, you know, the hardcore beta would be all comfort, and the hardcore kind of, like, you know, alpha chab, whatever, be all desire. But similar to what you're saying, I mean, I think that these guys give themselves too much credit. In many ways, it's about, and I'm not saying it's, you know, okay, they're sleeping with a woman, a woman wants to sleep with them. But I think the real test of how attractive you are on a real core level is, does she want to sleep with you again? Does she want to keep seeing you? If you represented everything she needed as an escape outlet for that night, okay, power to you, but don't think of yourself as like the most attractive guy in the world, like, this hot girl slept with me. I mean, she's in many ways the guy who she's the beta actually has more of a pull on her than you do. You know,
that's what they used to say, right? Mr. Right versus Mr. Right Now. It's like, right. You know, like, if you're a fairly attractive man that goes to a club 100 nights a year, then you're always going to run into a few girls that are just, like, down to have sex. They're just there to have sex, and you just happen to be there.
Yeah.
It's not because you're so special. It's just because you're there.
Yeah. And one of the things that you see in a lot of these relationships, I'm not going to deny that there are some cases where, and I'd say it's probably, you know, let's say 20 to 40% tops, 20 to 30% more realistically, where you have the guy is really just pure beta, and the woman walks over him and she's really, there's not desire there. And he needs to do things to create desire. And maybe even some elements of dread might be appropriate, actually, as a shock treatment, maybe, in that situation. But unfortunately, you have a lot of guys who have, you know, stale, stagnant marriages, and they go and they look at red pill stuff and they think, okay, I need to amp up the desire. That's the reason that the relationship isn't working. And, like, okay, fine. If you're not as masculine as you could be, if you're not as shape as you could be, yeah, work on that stuff. That's going to help. That's going to be important. But a lot of it is actually just the connection is, like, it's dissipated over time. You guys aren't connecting. The trust has collapsed as a result of the lack of connection. And that's why things aren't happening.
You know, the thing is, like, if using this paradigm, if you are, like, the ultimate beta, then there's no desire, you know, there's no, but if, on the other hand, you try to be too much of the alpha, then your dread, the amount of dread that you throw into her can also cause her to shut off and can also kill your sex life, because she just feels, you know, like, you put so much tension on her sexually, because, you know, like, she's like, oh no, like, if I don't please him well enough, then he might cheat or might leave me. You know, like, if you really push it in there, then, you know, then it becomes like this big exam, right? Like, oh, I have to pass this exam, and, like, I don't know if I studied well enough. And then you sit, like your palms are sweaty, and, like, you're like sitting in the exam room, and you don't know if you're gonna pass or fail. Like, a lot of stuff that you might know, like, once you're in that room making that exam, you just forget about it. You just cramp up. And this is the same with sex. Like, if you just, like, dread, she's going to cram up as well. She won't trust you to do, like, the real fantasies, you know, like, the real sexual exploration as well in such a long-term relationship, because she's just, like, because, you know, she's so afraid of your judgment. She's so afraid of your rejection that she'll just stick with what she knows. And it's like, okay, just gonna do this part of my sexuality, and this part we're just gonna leave out of it.
Yeah, and that's the reality for the majority of relationships. I mean, it actually creates more trust issues if you do any kind of active dread, and it can really fuck up the sex life more. I mean, I've had to do so much triage of guys who have, you know, swallowed the red pill and gotten massive diarrhea as a result of it. I mean, it's just totally fucked up, fucked up their marriages. You know, it is like surgery. I mean, and one of the things you can really tell whether it's desire or comfort, that's the main issue. And it's usually a combination. So you have to be, you know, delicate how you thread it. But if the issue is desire, then she doesn't want anything to do with you. She's ignoring you. She's doing stuff on her own. And she's mostly leaving you alone. If it's comfort, she's going to be creating drama and she's going to be nagging you and she's going to be, so that's actually like, guys are like, oh, she's nagging. She doesn't respect me. And I don't have desire. Well, actually it's more comfort here. It's more, she doesn't feel connected, because if she didn't feel any desire for you, she just wouldn't even waste her time with you.
I think, you know, we always act like men and women are so different, but often it's exactly the same. Like if you have a girlfriend, and you feel no desire for her, then you don't want to meet up with her. You know, you want to do the bare minimums, like almost never see her, and you almost never want to have sex with her. And if you live together, then, you know, like if she's in the living room, you're going to go to the study room to, you know, just want to be away from her. Whereas if you really desire her, but you feel anxious that she might leave you or whatever, then you'll constantly be like, you know, at her. And also that's also when guys start drama, you know, like, oh, I don't want you to go to the club this Friday. Like, whoa, whoa, whoa. It's all because they're scared of losing her. Mm-hmm. And they need comfort from her. So often when you have a situation with a woman, you can literally just flip it around and it still works. So you'd be like, okay, she's nagging me constantly. She's always like up in my, you know, like up in my neck, breathing in my neck, trying to be with me. Like, what would make me do the exact same thing to her?
Yeah.
That would be if I really love her, but I don't feel comfortable. That's when I would act like that to her. You know, like I'm insecure. I don't want her to leave. Like, so I'm just like, you know, like going to hold her like this the entire time so she can't go away.
Yeah, we maybe do it a little bit differently being men and women, but the energy and the fundamental impulse is the same. Yeah. It's the same.
It's also, you know, all these things with like hypergamy, solipsism. It's like, dude, as if you never like see like a hot girl walk by and be like, oh yeah, I definitely do her. Like, or like if you never met, like, okay, so you've been in a relationship for 5 years and not once have you met a woman where you'd be like, whoa, dating her will be an upgrade. Like, I mean, it's human nature to be a little bit greedy, to want more than you have, even if what you have is great. Same with solipsism. I mean, as if you're not selfish. Like, we're all selfish. Of course, you're always going to look at stuff from your own perspective. Of course, she's going to do the same. Like, what do you expect her to, you know, like everyone can be selfish. Everyone can fight for themselves except for her. Like, she just has to be that doormat, just accepts everything.
Well, the red pill guys are the most solipsistic of all, because, yeah. I mean, you know, for them, it's not like the existence of women is about, you know, should be catering to them and to their ego.
And they're also the most hypergamous. Projection. Because the only thing they care about is dating 5 supermodels. At the same time, I mean, that's like the pinnacle of hypergamy.
Yeah, it just, you know, male hypergamy is different than female hypergamy. I mean, this is the whole thing. It's like, do men have this is what women are capable of. Yeah, well, what are men capable of? I mean, how many women have experienced, I mean, the incredible pain? Can you imagine being married to a guy for 15 years, you know, having 2-3 kids with him, having this perfect little life, and, you know, she's been such a good, you know, stay-at-home mom and taking care of the kids, and you have this perfect little family, and then he fucks the secretary.
Yeah, or worse, he leaves you for the secretary.
Yeah, leaves you for the secretary. It's, I mean, like, there's no empathy whatsoever in no but these guys, like, oh yeah, this doesn't yeah, happens all the fucking time, and that's the dark side of men. I mean, so
it's both ways. I mean, we screw each other over both ways, and it's happened throughout history. Because also, you know, like, people is on about this trad thing, but, you know, trad, like, 1950s and before, it wasn't any better than it is now. It was worse in many regards. For instance, my grandmother once told me a story about, so she also comes from a little town. And like that little town, which had like maybe 5,000 people, at a certain point, it had like between 50 and 100 bars. And so we're talking like late 1800s now. And all these men, they would work in the factory because there were a few factories there. And on the Friday, they get their pay. And the first thing they do is go to one of the bars, get completely shit-faced, spend 80% of the money. And then the wife and 8 kids at home, they had to like make do with like 20% of the money. Mm-hmm. Alcoholism was rampant. And these were all the stay-at-home moms. And you'd be like, okay. So, you know, most of them weren't even stay-at-home moms because they had to work to make ends meet. But so these guys are like supposedly living the dream, right? So they work, they come home, they have a wife, they have their kids, and they have dinner ready. And all these guys went to the bar instead to get drunk. It's like, so apparently it wasn't that great. And a lot of these guys are fucking assholes. So I get why divorce laws, why they are the way they are, even if like these days it might go a little bit overboard into the direction of women. But I understand why they are the way they are, because that wasn't like it's very exceptional. Like for instance, I remember like, okay, so these are like big boogeymen, but I remember the socialist movement in the Netherlands, they had like this thing against the 4Ks they fought against. So it was the king, the church, which in Dutch is also the K, the bars and the capital. But like the bars was literally up there with the capital and the king and the church, because they knew like alcohol was, you know, like it was a horrible thing. And that was all because these women had no rights. You know, like they could do nothing. These guys would just go. So, you know, like we've always been horrible to each other, and there's never been an ideal moment in time where everything was perfect. Because if we truly reached this perfect thing, then it wouldn't fall apart. Like if 1950s home mom, like stay at home moms were so perfect, then why did it all fall apart? And don't give me the shtick about inflation, that kind of stuff. It's just, it was a horrible situation. It was just boring as hell for these women. And they all started cheating. Like if you're a 1950 stay-at-home mom, then there's a reason why there's so many jokes about the milkman. It's because the milkman got laid in those days because...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and, you know, women were on Valium. It was the first time of like antidepressants. I mean, it really was a bullshit period in many ways. I mean, I'm sure that there were a lot of happy people and there was a lot of economic prosperity. But at the end of the day, it was as far away from, you know, natural dynamics between men and women as it is. It's, as far as I've been able to tell, it's basically like an offshoot of upper class WASP culture, where you try to keep these, you know, educated women in their little glass cages. And that's where actually feminism developed. You don't see any of that shit from like Slavic women, because they've had to deal with shit all time. You know what I mean? They've had real problems, real lives. They don't need any kind of fake ego prop up like a lot of these women do. And that's what feminism has become. It's an ego prop up. But you can understand, I mean, prior to the 1950s, like, okay, you had people who worked on a farm. Well, did the women not do anything on the farm? They just sat around and, you know, no, come on. I mean, there was division of labor.
So I saw this article 2 days ago. So in India right now, there's a huge heat wave, and they were interviewing these people in the countryside. This is like a family that you would say was common in the West as well 200 years ago. Like family has a little farm, they all work on it. And they were like, oh yeah, the heat wave is extra brutal on the women, because her job was to go to the water pump and back like 5 times a day to get water. And then she'd have to help in the field in the sun. And then she'd get home, but then she'd have to cook in like this like shitty like kitchen sort of thing with like a big pot. And inside it would also be like 50 degrees plus. So it'd be like, you know, like, because like, and then the guy would like sit in the shade because
50 Celsius for people who.
Yeah, so I don't know, it's like 110, 120.
That's huge. 50 Celsius is like over 100, you know.
It's horrible.
Yeah.
So it's like, yeah, these were the traditional families. Like she's working just as hard as him. And then at the end of the day, when he like sits like underneath a tree because he's so tired from work, then she still has to make the food for them and their 5 kids. This is the traditional family. I can show this beautifully because, so on my dad's side, my great grandfather was a preacher. So his wife was a stay-at-home mom, but they had like 11 kids, but still she stayed at home. On my mother's side, they were all workers. So my mother's side, working class, every woman in the family had a job. Yeah. You know, like either they run the shoe store or they work in the family business, you know, like have a butcher shop and she would help sell. And then, so my one grandmother was like upper middle class. She would be like pristine candidate for feminism because she's just at home bored. But basically she's championing for women's rights just to get what the working class women already have, because those are already working. So it's so weird because you create this situation where the upper class, you don't have to work, but then you get like hissy fits because you do want to work. It's like, oh no, no, you get this entire movement. It's just about like, basically we want to be working class again because, you know, we hate this so bad. Like we'd rather be working than this.
Yeah. They want to, you know, it's a self-esteem issue fundamentally.
Yeah.
And so like, oh, if I work, I'm going to have more self-esteem, but then they get there and they have all the entitlement. And then they work, you know, modified for them and to make them feel better about it. And yeah, women who are actually developed don't give a fuck about it at all.
I think it's also like at the end of the day, everyone wants to feel useful,
mm-hmm.
and everyone also wants to feel special. But how special you want to feel depends on your standards. And if you've always been this super, you know, like this rich upper class, always had everything handed to you, then you do want to feel useful.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you want to be very special. So you don't just want a job. You want a job that's important. You know, you just want to be given to you because you've always been rich. Everything has always been given to you. Whereas if you're working class, then you do want to be useful. But your sense of feeling special, like it's way less hard to feel special. Like you'll feel special if you can at the end of the week be like, hey, I brought home an extra $100 so we can go out for McDonald's like this one time. Because then all the kids and the dads are like, yay, you know, like then you're already special. Whereas the upper class ones like, oh yeah, I've been working for 3 months and I still haven't solved world peace. Oh, somebody needs to get me a better job, you know, like.
Yeah. And, you know, they're also often more appreciative if, like, as a man, you did bring in more and you allowed them a little bit more of a break because they know what it's like to actually have to work for stuff.
And yeah, my one grandmother worked all her life. Super easygoing, like sweetest person you can imagine. Very, how you call it in English? Like almost you have to like, if you ask her like, hey, do you want to join us? She's like, really? Like, can I join? Whereas my other grandmother never worked a day in her life. And she was a very sweet woman. Like, I don't want to bash on her, but sure. No, she'd be at the front, be like, okay, of course I'm joining you guys. Like of course you're inviting me. Like, you know, like, yeah. And it's such a different mindset. Like my one grandmother is way more appreciative. The other one just took everything for granted. And I can't blame her. Like, you know, like that's the way she grew up. That's all she knew. But yeah, and this isn't just about women. Men are just the same. You know, like a lot of guys these days, that's for instance, you know, like that's, I think the entire Red Pill movement, you can see as a men feeling that they're owed these hot women to just love them for some reason, because all their lives they had this sense that, you know, like they grew up in relative wealth. Because I think that's, if you do a survey of the manosphere, you're going to find very few like working class guys. Like, yeah. You know, like the guys that had to work from day one and always grew up in poverty. You're not really going to find those. You're going to find the upper middle class kids, you know, like in the suburbs behind that computer. It's like, hey, why don't I have five hoes? Like, you're, it's same old, same old.
Yeah. Now, the one thing I will say, though, to men, because, you know, we talked about how like the guys would come back from the factory and they'd just get shit faced and spend all the money. The one thing that I do have to say in their defense is that a lot of these guys, like, they weren't living in a natural system. And especially once the Industrial Revolution happened, men were thrown off the land, essentially. They moved off the land where it was normal to be able to have some balance and some degree of rest at least seasonally, you know, during harvest time, okay, you're going to be working all the time, but, and they go to the factory, they're working 70, 80, 90, maybe 100 hours a week in literally sometimes toxic conditions. Like if you were in a coal mine and, you know, massive hazards, industrial hazards. So these guys were totally traumatized. And
oh, for sure.
And so, like, you know, they get their money after all that, and they're like, fuck it, I'm just gonna go, like, go.
You know, like, I'm not blaming those men. It's like, nobody wants to be an alcoholic, right?
Yeah.
And this also, it's like one of those things, almost everyone drinks. Very few people actually become alcoholics. And usually it's not just about the drinking. There's something else behind it, why they become an alcoholic. There's a trauma or, like, some issue. There's very few people who become alcoholics just because they love alcohol so much.
Well, this just kind of came to mind, and it's been often attributed to the nature of the alcohol difference. And I think that might be part of it, but there's another interesting thing here. When you look at where you had the really, really massive rates of alcoholism and then, you know, corresponding temperance movements, it was all in industrial Northern Europe.
Oh yeah.
In America. It wasn't like if you go to like France, Italy, Greece, I mean, it was common for the average Frenchman to have two bottles of wine a day. Now, caveat,
wine is like more
alcohol now than it used to be. It would have been probably like 11, 12% tops, maybe even 10 to 12% during that time period, which is a big difference on the scale. So maybe let's just say they would certainly have a bottle of wine a day. But the whole, like, it's kind of interesting to think about that you didn't, I mean, not to say that the men didn't, you know, didn't go out and drink and everything, but there wasn't this kind of, like, insane, like, dysfunctional alcoholism that occurred. And I wonder how much of that had to do with, like, you're a French guy and, you know, you run a, you know, not so lucrative farm, it kind of just gets by, but you know, you're able to sort of just manage it, and you have your bottle of wine at lunch and your bottle of wine at dinner, versus the guys who are in the factory and they come out and they're just like,
I can give you an example. So this is 2014. Yeah, 2014. I was in Mexico, this little village, and I forgot what it's called, but it was this indigenous village. Had this weird Christianity voodoo crossover thing in the church. But they had like an unemployment rate of 60-70%. And it was a very much a place filled with despair. Like literally there would be maybe 50 tourists every day that would come there, and they had like 100 stalls. So, you know, as soon as the tourist bus came, like everyone just rushed to the stalls and like hoping they could sell one or two things. And while I was there, there was a huge line in the town square with all women and kids waiting for government handouts. They would only give the handouts to the women because what happened in that village, all the men made their own alcohol. They made this super strong corn-based alcohol. And I'm talking, this is 3 p.m. in the afternoon. There were guys on the street just lying there. They were so drunk they couldn't even get up anymore. And I think that's the one common thing that you'll see anywhere that has high rates of alcoholism and other uses of drugs is just despair.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's what happened to the Rush in the 90s.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a whole other story. But yeah, I mean, the life expectancy dropped to 58 among men. I mean, guys, just once the industry got looted, they're just like,
see the same thing happening in parts of the U.S. now. But it's not alcohol, but it's like meth and it's fentanyl and it's all these like... It's just despair, and then people look for relief. But I guess we got a little bit off topic here.
Yeah, no, especially the men. Well, look, I know I've said 2 hours, we're already over. It's just been such a good conversation. There is one more thing. It's tracking backwards, but I really wanted to ask you about it. Going back to sex, just to close with this, unless you know you have other stuff you want to say. But you mentioned guys who don't have any sexual energy, you know, woman's not going to be attracted to a lamppost. How do guys develop and channel their sexual energy? What is, you know, manage to bring it out? How do they do that, that they make a woman able to feel it?
it's a big topic. There's a lot of aspects here. I think first one, simple, physical. You know, like if you're a guy that's like 100 pounds overweight, last time you saw the sun was 3 years ago, you know, like you haven't been to a dentist in 8 years. If you're that kind of guy and you were like whatever you find at Gap for like $10, I mean, that's like the easiest way. Well, maybe not the easiest if you have to lose weight and stuff, but that's the most obvious way to change your sex appeal. So this is undeniable that a guy that's in shape, you know, with a nice tan and like good clothes, a nice haircut, it's just, you know, it's sexual. It's just like a woman that's like in shape, wears a nice dress, wears heels, it's sexual. It's like, it's just there. You can't deny it. It's there. Like, even if you don't want it to be there, it's still there.
Yeah.
But it's also mental. I mean, the biggest issue is guys are so afraid of sexual tension, because once there's tension, there's a chance that you get rejected. So a lot of guys is afraid of it. And like we said with the manosphere thing, like, you know, like you also get a bar that you have to pass. You know, there's certain expectations. There's certain things that, like, requirements that you have to meet. You're going to get judged. A lot of guys are just afraid of that. And so you have to embrace being an idiot, basically. You have to embrace, you know, getting rejected, getting a door slammed into your face. You have to embrace that you're going to make stupid mistakes. You have to embrace that you're going to walk up to a girl and be like, you know, like, it's total blank. It just, you know, it happens. Like, I had a little blank out in the beginning of a conversation. It just happens. Like, it's two things that you can do. Is either like the rest of like the next 1.5 hours, it can be like, oh shit, I can't have another blank up. I have to. Or you can just be like, oh yeah, it happened. No, I'm a bit of a scatterbrained person. It happens. And I think that's a big part that guys can work on as well. And I think only after those two things, that's maybe when the techniques and the game and stuff comes in. Because if you don't have those two in check, like if you don't, I'm not saying you have to be like a Olympian level athlete or something, but you have to be presentable and you have to be mentally willing to take some risks and willing to make mistakes, willing to learn. And you also have to have the belief that you are a sexual being, you know, like, and there's nothing wrong with wanting to have sex, wanting to have relationships, wanting to be loved. That's all very normal. And I think those two things are the most important. I think if you have those two in order, the rest will, you know, like the rest will sort itself out. You know, maybe you might not be the biggest player out there. You might not be the most successful guy in relationships, but you'll be good enough at it. And once you reach that level, that's when you can start looking at, okay, maybe there are some clear mistakes that I make. And if I read this book on the game, then I'll be like, oh, okay, so I shouldn't come over to girls and be like, hey, and instead just show some masculinity, show some energy. But even like if you're a very confident man that's in shape, you can literally go over to girls and be like, hey, and sometimes it will work.
Yeah.
That's the one thing that all those serious guys just don't get, is that you can get away with a lot of really stupid stuff. You know, it just works. Like, you can hit on girls, you know, pretending that you're a cowboy or something, wearing leather pants, and like some girls will just fall for it. Like, if you bring the vibe, if you bring the energy, if you bring the confidence, you know, some girls will be like, okay, sure, you're a cowboy, let's play.
Yeah,
it's,
you have to be grounded though. You have to be grounded, yeah. You have to be present. And I think a lot of guys, when they get into their head and they disassociate, they're trying to think, they're thinking, that's when the energy gets shut down between him and the woman. It's
they want to be perfect because they're scared of that rejection. They want to be the perfect Mr. Smooth that will get a 100% success rate, but it just doesn't exist. Like, it's just one of those fairy tales. Like, get it out of your head. Like, you can be Mr. Perfect and still get rejected by half the women.
Yeah.
You know, for whatever reason.
Yeah, I mean, if you go up to a woman and you feel desire for her, and you look at her and you know, almost to feel that you want her, that you're sexually attracted to her, that feeling is what starts to charge your sexuality, and then other women start to feel that from you. And so that's, you drop down. And I mean, it's everything you're talking about, is being present, and it's tapping into your own own desire rather than thinking like, I'm, you know, this woman's attractive. How do I make her desire me? It's like, well, what do you, and that's the thing. It's like women at the end, any kind of romance novel, any kind of fantasy thing that they have, it comes down to them being desired mm-hmm. by, you know, a powerful man, an attractive, strong man, but like they want to be desired.
I think that's the main use of game is that, let's say I have a guy that has zero game, but he does have that confidence. He'll walk up to her, but he won't know exactly what to do. So it will become a little bit creepy, maybe, or awkward, because he'll just be there with like sexual energy. And, you know, he doesn't know how to guide it.
Yeah.
So all game does is take that sexual energy and make it socially acceptable. But a lot of guys focus so much on the game, but they don't have that sexual energy. Like, they don't have the undercurrent. They don't feel confident in themselves. And it's better to be very sexually secure and have that energy and then have mediocre game than to have the best game in the world, but you just don't have that sexual energy. Because then you'll just be like this, I guess, like social friendly guy that's just like, okay, it's nice to have him around, but, you know, it's not very sexual.
Yeah.
I think that's the one thing that most guys just don't understand about dating. It's about having that core. You know, like you said, you have to be grounded. Mm-hmm. And then the game thing is just, by the time you have that grounding done and you know, you're sort of okay with game, the details don't matter. Like I said, you can literally walk up to a bunch of girls like, hey, and they'll just, you know, just be like, oh, hey, hello.
Niels, it's been a pleasure. I know we're already over, but this has just been such a good conversation. Just,
yeah, thank you, man. Thank you for having me on.
I'm going to put the links and stuff, but where can people find you, kind of your services? I know you're on Twitter.
Yeah, it's mostly on Twitter. So I go by Niels KNK. So it's the N of Nicholas. Also, my website is called neilsknk.com. So, and I also have a Substack, which is neilsknk.substack.com. So it's either one of those. But you can go to my Twitter and you'll find the rest. Thank you for having me, and looking forward to when this gets released.
Yeah, it'll be released just in a few days. I'll release it probably later this week. But it's a pleasure, brother.
Yeah, we'll have you on likewise. Again. Thank you.